Chapter 1. Darwinism in Our Time. In 1949, C.S. Lewis wrote to a friend that evolution, etc., was the assumed background of modern thought. Then, in the discarded image, he argued that a developing world, by which he meant an evolving one, was obviously in harmony with the revolutionary and the romantic temper. He was specifically thinking of Darwin's theory. As history unfolds, he continued, later generations are likely to look for a new model or worldview. That search may well precede any evidence pointing to or requiring such a transformation. But when the desire for a new outlook matures, scientists go to work and discover the evidence. Nature, Lewis went on, has all sorts of phenomena in stock and can suit many different tastes. In short, the model of a particular time reflects the prevalent psychology of an age almost as much as it reflects the state of that age's knowledge. The worldview of Lewis's day was likely to change sooner or later, and we seem to be in such a transition period today, and perhaps have been for a decade or longer. Three or four such changes are worth noting. The first, and perhaps most important, is the loss of the idea of progress. Throughout, progress is capitalized to denote the philosophy as it existed in Darwin's day. See chapter 21. In Darwin's day, progress was thought of as an all-embracing fact. In his autobiography, Darwin said that man in the distant future will be a far more perfect creature than he now is. He also said at the end of The Origin of Species that all corporeal and mental endowments will tend to progress toward perfection. Few believe anything like that today. The word evolution does not occur once in The Origin. Evolved appears once. It is the last word in the book. Instead, Darwin referred to improvement, which does convey the idea of progress. Either improved or improvement appears dozens of times. Victorian philosophers, Darwin among them, were immersed in the idea of progress. They were, Lewis wrote, favored members of the happiest class in the happiest country in the world at the world's happiest period. They took progress for granted. One only has to read statements by our environmentalists to see how much things have changed. Mankind today is seen as the ruination of the planet. The alleged extinction of recent or contemporary species is blamed on human carelessness, while climate change, assumed to be anthropogenic, has become a major cause. Supposed remedies take precedence over such mundane matters as economic growth and the well-being of the poor. They are embraced by the ruling class all over Europe and the Western world. The second change is demographic. Fertility rates have fallen below replacement level right across the Western world. Food production widely outpaces population growth, and obesity exceeds hunger as a health risk. Thomas Robert Malthus would not have expected that. According to his calculations, population increased geometrically and was destined to outrun food supply. Furthermore, Darwin's theory of evolution was directly inspired by the Malthusian doctrine. The worldview underlying Darwinism conformed to the spirit of its age, that of the late Enlightenment. As long as the two were broadly aligned, Darwin's philosophy was accepted by most scientists, and therefore by most educated laymen. Articles in academic journals were waved through the familiar checkpoints. Peer review, for example, is sometimes used as a barrier to entry for non-approved science. Within the academic world, dissenters from Darwinism could be expelled. As for biology departments, no dissent is permitted for untenured faculty. Creationist has become the accusation of choice against dissenters, while authoritarianism or scientism is frequently substituted for science. Nonetheless, we are seeing a tide that is slowly turning. Faith in evolutionism, and it is a faith, has declined, along with the new hostility to progress. That is to be expected because a progressive philosophy was built into Darwinism from the beginning. At the same time, large holes have begun to appear in the science. the intelligent design movement, which rose to prominence in the 1990s and was promptly dismissed by the Academy, has flourished. The philosopher and mathematician William A. Dembski, one of the founders of the movement, said recently that it has grown internationally and has pressed Western intellectuals to take seriously the claim that life and the cosmos are the product of intelligence. To be sure, many of them reject this claim, but their need to confront and refute it suggests that our mental environment is no longer stagnating in the atheistic materialism that for so long has dominated Western intellectual life. With atheistic materialism now itself in question, Christianity is again on the table for discussion. As an additional change, one might also mention the digital revolution, and with it, the internet. It is comparable in magnitude to the change wrought by the printing press in the 15th century. What the long-term effect of the digital revolution will be, no one can foresee. But it is decentralizing the flow of information, and to the previously marginalized, the cost of information has been greatly reduced. One might say that the flow of information is being democratized. In particular, criticism of Darwin's theory of evolution now reaches many more people than it did when journals like Science and Nature were able to dominate science news. For a decade or two, Darwinism's promoters and beneficiaries, most of them lodged within universities, will pretend that nothing much is happening. But the auguries are not good. Those who claim to live by science will eventually die by science. Historians thrive because it is difficult to know in detail what happened 100 years ago, let alone 1,000. Darwinists benefit from the great difficulty of knowing what happened 1,000,000 years ago, not to mention 1,000,000,000. They are pleased to think that because some skeptics reject their extrapolations and conclusions, they are opposed to science. But as I hope to show in the following chapters, the science of neo-Darwinism was poor all along and supported by very few facts. I have become ever more convinced that, although Darwinism has been promoted as science, its unstated role has been to prop up a philosophy, the philosophy of materialism and atheism along with it. Darwin's House of Cards. Darwinism was once a well-fortified castle with elaborate towers, moats, and battlements. It remained in that condition for well over 100 years, from the publication of The Origin of Species in 1859 to the Darwin Centennial, and then for perhaps 3 decades after that. Today, however, it more closely resembles a house of cards, built out of flimsy icons rather than hard evidence, and liable to blow away in the slightest breeze. David Gelernter, who survived one of the Unabomber's mailed explosive devices, said in 2014 that attacking Darwin is the sin against the Holy Ghost that pious scientists are taught never to forgive. That is mostly still true today, but the times are changing. In November 2016, the Royal Society in London, one of the world's most eminent scientific societies, convened a group of scientists to discuss calls for revision of the standard theory of evolution, acknowledging that the issues involved remain hotly contested. The meeting itself appears to have been a dud, with nothing genuinely capable of rescuing the standard theory having been proposed. But the fact that the meeting was convened at all is telling. It offers hope that the issues to be discussed in the following chapters may yet receive a serious airing.